Humans are one of the few animals found on every continent. This isn't just because we're adaptable, we're also really good at moving around. But while we know that humans are excellent travelers, we still don't know how or when our ancestors ended up in certain places. Like the Americas. The when, how, and even who of human migration to the Americas has been a running debate in anthropology for decades. Some scientists even think that humans weren't the first hominin species to make it here. But that idea is not without its critics, and scientists love a good debate. So let's take a look at a few different ideas about who might have been the winner of that great American race. Before we get into the hot takes, let's start with what we know with some certainty. Most researchers agree that the earliest Americans likely got here by crossing the Bering Strait, the 85-kilometer gap between Russia and North America. During the last glacial maximum, about 19 to 26,000 years ago, sea levels were much lower than they are now because so much ice was frozen into glaciers. That lower sea level meant that previously submerged land between the continents was surface level for a while, so people and animals were just able to walk across. The other thing that researchers agree on is the most recent possible time of arrival. We're fairly confident that humans were living across the entirety of the Americas by about 13,000 years ago, which is a good start, but it still leaves a lot unexplained. Like, there might have been one group of people who crossed the land bridge and then spread out over the entirety of the continents, or there could have been multiple waves of migration. There's also a precursor question before we get to when people reached the Americas, which is when they reached the Bering Strait. We don't know if they entered the region around the Bering Strait, aka Beringia, and hung out there for a while before expanding their range, or if they just marched right on through. These early Beringians most likely got there from Siberia, but again, when they got there is a bit unclear. See, up until about 13,500 years ago, Beringia was surrounded by ice sheets that would have been impossible to cross. If they had left Siberia before the ice sheets melted, they probably would have had to stay there for a while before they were able to reach the rest of the continent. But if they got to Beringia closer to when the ice melted, they could have just come across and continued on their way in one big migration wave, which is called the Clovis First Hypothesis. The idea is that all of the people living across the Americas descended from one migratory group called the Clovis people, who got their name from an archaeological site in Clovis, New Mexico, where researchers first found their signature stone tools. Tools that were constructed in the same way have also been found at sites across North and South America, which would make sense if the people inhabiting all of those different sites had learned to make tools the same way from the same ancestors. However, there's another option for how humans may have gotten to the Americas if not by land, or in this case, land bridge, they could have taken the seafaring route. Some have hypothesized that when modern humans entered Beringia, they didn't have to wait for the ice sheets to melt. They could have hopped in some boats and navigated through passageways where the ice had already melted, and then down along the Pacific coast, stopping to camp on the shoreline along the way. They would have had a good source of food in the kelp forests close to the shore, too. This would also open up the possibility that humans could have gotten to the Americas much earlier than the ice sheets opened up. This is a super hard hypothesis to test, though, because the sea level rise that sank the Bering land bridge would have also left any of the evidence of these occupations underwater. Without any evidence in the form of, like, a boat? Most anthropologists agreed that the most likely answer was that humans came in one big wave from Siberia and then spread out pretty rapidly across the continent about 13,000 years ago. The genetic evidence suggests that there were at least two other populations of ancient people who came over from Asia and settled in the Americas after that. But in the past few decades, we've found evidence of human populations in the Americas dating back several thousand years earlier, meaning that if they're legit, the land bridge would have been unavailable for those people to get here. There are sites from Canada to Chile that are at least 16,000 years old. Some of these are more widely accepted than others, but anthropologists do now tend to agree that humans have been here at least that long. But there are some sites that researchers claim contain evidence of human occupation earlier than that 16,000 year mark. And these are the ones that get archaeologists to throw down the gauntlet, or trowel, if you will. So there's one site in Texas that's between 16 and 20,000 years old, where stone tools were discovered that don't look like the ones from Clovis sites, which the researchers argue means that the people who made them predate the Clovis people. They use this to contest both the Clovis first hypothesis and also the earliest possible arrival of humans, which they say is at least 2,500 years before the Clovis people got there. It's a bit surprising, but not outside the realm of possibility, especially if the site is at the younger end of the range. But in 2021, researchers announced that they had found human footprints in White Sands National Park in New Mexico that pushed human occupation back even further. The researchers used carbon dating on seeds embedded in the footprint layer to determine that these footprints were between 21 and 23,000 years old. But other researchers pointed out a problem. Sometimes when you carbon date the type of seeds that they found, they can look thousands of years older than they actually are due to the type of carbon the plants use in photosynthesis. With some real per my last email energy, the original researchers fired back, acknowledging that while that was true, they'd already considered it, and that their original paper, quote, presented several lines of evidence that argued against such a problem. Trust me, to academics, these are fighting words. And while they can't agree on how old the footprints are, there's no question that humans made them, unlike some of other finds. Like the stone tools that researchers found in a cave in Zacatecas, Mexico, called Chiquihuite, that date back as far as 33,000 years. Another research group reanalyzed the images the authors provide and determined that what the first paper argues are stone tools are far more likely to be just broken up rocks than human-made tools. See, there are certain signs that anthropologists look for to determine whether a rock was shaped by human or natural forces. Things like whether the places where rock has been flaked off overlap or if they're randomly distributed, whether there's evidence that a sharp rock has been resharpened, and whether the breaks line up with the mineral structure of the rock. And these other researchers said that the original authors didn't do enough to show that these rocks weren't just rocks. In the spirit of constructive criticism, they included a numbered list of 10 different analyses they think the original authors should have done in order to more strongly support their case. But whether or not these individual sites are verified, it's becoming more clear that the Clovis first hypothesis can't be the only explanation, since there are so many potential sites of human occupation that predate the Clovis people, which means there's still a lot to uncover and a lot to argue about. And then, there's the Cerutti Mastodon. But before we get into that, all research needs funding, so here's a little bit about ours.
This SciShow video is supported by Triple 10, a beginner-friendly online education platform. As a SciShow viewer, you know that education doesn't have to happen in a classroom. And sometimes, flexible learning on a schedule that's compatible with your day job gets you where you want to go more effectively, especially if you want to make a pivot in your career and get a high-paying job in tech that allows for remote work and life balance. Triple 10 can help you get there with beginner-friendly online boot camps and unlimited externship opportunities even after graduation. They're so confident in your success that they offer 100% compensation if you don't find a job. You can put yourself on that path using the code SciShow for 30% off on all their programs. You even get a free career consultation at the link in the description or using the QR code.
So let's talk about a mammoth-sized archaeology beef. Construction workers in California discovered the broken bones of a mastodon next to some large broken rocks. When anthropologists from the nearby San Diego Natural History Museum took a look, what they found was pretty unbelievable. The bones appeared to have been broken while they were still fresh, which is consistent with human butchery of hunted carcasses. The nearby rocks had wear and tear patterns you'd see if they had been used as hammers and anvils, all of which suggests that humans were here. Except there was a problem. The site was 130,000 years old. Over 100,000 years older than the already super controversial Chiquihuite site. So it shouldn't surprise you that when they published their findings, there was a lot of pushback. One rebuttal brought up the possibility that the bones had simply been damaged by the construction equipment. They also questioned whether the dating process they used was accurate, and even pointed out that other mastodons had been found with the exact same fracture patterns, but with no evidence of human activity nearby. But its overall message really seemed to be, this makes no sense given everything else we know. A second research group jumps in to back up the rebuttal, saying that they've also seen similar bone fractures on mammoths with no human activity activity nearby. It's worth pointing out that these controversial mastodon bones have plenty of percussion marks, but really no slashing or cutting marks, which are indications of slicing meat off a bone and are usually a much more telltale sign that humans made that thing their dinner. After all, bones can break in all kinds of ways, not just because humans hit them with rocks. The original authors publish rebuttals to the rebuttals, then other researchers come off the top rope to have their say. So now we have the academic equivalent of a rap beef with papers flying back and forth reiterating, here are the reasons you're wrong. No, here are the reasons you're wrong. It is chaos, which is kind of to be expected when you have something that would change everything we think we know about not just the history of the Americas, but the history of the world. Because 130,000 years ago, Homo sapiens were still 30,000 years away from leaving Africa. And the earliest evidence we have of our own species in Northeast Asia dates back to 50,000 years ago. Which would mean that our own species couldn't be the ones who broke those mastodon bones, and some other hominin species would have had to get to North America before we did. To be clear, we aren't the first long-distance trekking species in our family tree. Hominins made it all the way from Africa to Europe around a million years ago, so an ancient species going on an adventure and spreading out isn't entirely unprecedented. But the Bering Land Bridge didn't exist 130,000 years ago. It would still be submerged underwater for another 100,000-ish years. That's pretty compelling evidence that they couldn't have walked to the Americas. The other option is boats. Just like with the humans navigating a frozen Bering Strait, the idea is that this human ancestor species took the water route to get where they wanted to go. And there is evidence supporting some degree of Homo sapiens boat migration in the Americas 14,000 years ago. So getting to the Americas by boat isn't out of the realm of possibility, it's just a question of whether hominins that weren't us were able to, you know, do that. There is evidence of early hominins using boats to reach new areas in Asia, with Homo erectus finding their way to islands a million plus years ago, but those journeys were much shorter, and again, we don't have any of the boats they used. Homo sapiens only started taking long-distance sea voyages roughly 50,000 years ago, and even then, we're talking trips of 100 kilometers. So for the pre-human boat hypothesis to be true, it would require that an earlier hominin species developed long-distance sea faring skills 80,000 years before humans did, left behind no evidence of a single stop along the way to break up the trip, and then never did it again. Which is a pretty tough sell. So right now, there isn't really robust evidence supporting a species before ours making it to the Americas, and the majority of researchers think these bones are just old broken bones. It's one of those extraordinary claims require extraordinary evidence things, and for a lot of people, these mastodon bones just don't cut it. As we've seen, it can be really hard to interpret the types of evidence that we do have. But this is what science does so well. Scientists hypothesize, test, argue, and refine, all with the goal of getting as close to the truth as we can. So hopefully, once more evidence comes to light, we'll have a more conclusive and agreeable answer to exactly how humans made it to the Americas. But that certainly won't stop researchers from arguing about it in the meantime.